You know, yoga means link, connection, communion, union, whatever. But often Baba says, don't use the word yoga. Because it looks like a very technical term. And sometimes people find it difficult. They say, oh, I cannot have yoga. So instead, use the word remembrance. A remembrance is something which all of us can relate to. Why? Because we always remember someone, we remember something, some place. Life is remembrance. And remembrance is always connected with relationship. If you are not related to someone or something, you don't remember. So remembrance is based on two things: relationship and love. Where there is love, there is relationship. And where there is relationship, there is remembrance. So when we look at Laukic life, you can think about three types of remembrance. We don't use the word yoga anymore. We use word remembrance instead. So remembrance is of three types. Generally, one type is remembrance for which you have to make effort. So you have to make effort to remember someone or something. Second thing is remembrance is natural. Of course, the third type of relationship, remembrance, is what we call sometimes in Baba's Murli also troublesome remembrance. A remembrance which you cannot forget, even if you want to forget. It is so frequent. It is so intense that you cannot forget. And so we can relate that to Baba's remembrance also. So sometimes some souls make a lot of effort to remember Baba. You know, they are battling, mind is wandering, coming back again. It's like a struggling remembrance. But second type, I think we can always say, it's based on relationship. You know, you remember someone with whom you have relationship naturally. So, like, a student remember the teacher, a doctor remember the patient, a child remembers the parents. It's no struggle. It's just natural. When I think I'm a student, I remember teacher, that's all. It's a natural remembrance. Of course, it is based on relationship and love. But that kind of remembrance, you know, just natural. Of course, I have to make first remembrance natural, then it is easy. If it is not natural, it is not easy, and when it is not easy, it is not constant. So to make remembrance constant, I should make it easy, and I should make it natural. So try to do it on the basis of relationship and love. When you have relationship based on love, remembrance is natural. Now that remembrance itself is not enough for us to burn the sins. You know, Baba says, through the power of yoga, through the power of remembrance, we burn our sins. And what is called the fire of yoga. So that is what is called troublesome remembrance. And we all have experience in our life one or two people. You cannot say everybody's remembrance is troublesome. No, you cannot say that. Maybe one or two people with whom we have a kind of, you know, feeling that they are the part and parcel of our life. They are the support, they are the protector. So someone whom we think in that way, their remembrance becomes intense, which means that it becomes so frequent that I cannot forget. So how to make Baba's remembrance troublesome? Or how to make remembrance into fire? So for that, I have to make sure I have all relationships with Baba and I experience all attainments from Baba. So then there is no way my mind and intellect can wander and remembrance can get intensified. You know? So, because the mind and intellect have only two places to go. If you look at your mind and intellect, where does it go? Even when you are not having good remembrance, say for example, where does your mind wander? It goes either to the relationships because of attachment, or it goes towards attainments because of unfulfilled desires. You know, you have desire for something and you haven't got it, so the mind wanders there. Or you have attachment with someone, even if they are dead also, but still you remember them. So, but now we know that from experience, that physical relationship is temporary, momentary, perishable. So it is not going to last all the time. So why should I take sorrow for myself by getting my intellect pulled? So that is why Baba says, you know, we have to look at yogi as a life. It is not a job, you know. So when I look at yogi jivan, yoga as a way of living, then I can understand that it has to be based on relationships and attainments. You don't remember someone for nothing. You get something from them, so you remember them. So I have to check myself. How do I approach the subject of yoga? You can look at it as a pilgrimage also. You can look at it as a drill also. You can look at it as an exercise. But that is not going to help you to make your remembrance constant. Because you don't do it all the time, exercise, remembrance, pilgrimage, once in a while. So it is relationship that is always existing. So it is good to approach remembrance in the form of relationship. It becomes natural and it is based on love. So as a soul, I don't have anybody else except Baba. See, when you think of yourself as a body, your mother is separate, father is separate, teacher is separate, everyone is separate. So you have to remember them separately. But here, all in one. Baba is everything. You are the mother, you are the father. That is why in bhakti also we say, Tvameva Matasya Pita Tvameva. But do I have the experience of the love of all relationships? That is the question. Have I tasted the love of a child and father relationship with Baba? And have I fulfilled the responsibility of my relationship? It is not just like, you know, in Laukik life, somebody will say, I love you, you love me. That kind of relationship will not do with Baba. You know, but it has to be real. So, do I have that experience of fulfilling the responsibility of love as a child to the father, as a child to the mother, as a student to the teacher? Then I can feel the taste of that love. So if any relationship is missing, my intellect is void, empty. So my intellect wanders. It goes towards physical relationship to draw that love. So in this world, anybody who gives you that love that you are lacking, you fall in love with them. It could be anybody. Any religion, any culture, any age, doesn't matter. But you get that love from them, so you go after them. But if I have all relationship with Baba, I will have love for all, but I would not fall in love with anyone. Because I have already experienced love from Baba. So I have to take each relationship separately and check myself. You know, have I really filled myself with that love? So then there is that feeling of fulfillment. Nothing is lacking. The same thing with attainments also. The desires are such, it makes you wander around the world. Now we find many times people sit in yoga, remembrance, but they are not remembering. They are doing window shopping. Yeah, because they have desire, so they are standing in front of a showcase of a shopping center and looking at the things and fulfilling their desires by just looking at it, because they cannot have it, they don't have money to buy. So my yoga is not perfect in a way. You know, there is a leakage. Huh? There is link is not accurate. That is why many people cannot focus their intellect, because it's life. So whenever you are sitting in remembrance of Baba, if my mind wanders towards relationships, towards attainments, physical objects out of desire, I must not leave it as something common. I must sit with myself and pull my ears and ask this question to myself. Why did you go there? Why my intellect went towards this direction? What is it that I get from them? That which Baba has not given. Baba has given, but I have not taken. So the intellect goes. So I have to make sure I feel contentment. I feel the feeling I have everything. Verbally you may say, but still you're why you don't have concentration. You know? Why my intellect wanders? Why some people fall asleep when they are sitting in meditation? Yeah? Why? When if two people who have love for each other, they sit and talk, night also becomes day. And here in day also they are sleeping, night also and day also. Why? Because my intellect is not stimulated with that relationship. I am not fascinated. You know, there is no intimacy in that love, very superficial. So my intellect is void. It's not engaged. You know, when you're talking to somebody on the telephone, will you ever fall asleep? Because you are conversing, you are actively participating. You cannot fall asleep. So this is also not a good sign in meditation. My mind and intellect is empty. Lack of love. So I have to really sit with myself and pull my ears and make myself realize. You know, what it means to have all relationships and all attainments from one Baba? It means to live in Baba's world. That means my intellect has stepped away from this world. I have realized that this world has no essence. It is tasteless. So I have realized, so I don't want my intellect and mind to be stuck here. So I have already lifted. But if that is not happening, so which means that I am traveling in two boats. I want taste from this world, I want taste from Baba also. So you go nowhere. You know, when you travel in two boats, what happens? You don't go anywhere. You are where you are. So ask yourself, do I really have kind of feeling of tastelessness towards this world? Is there any taste left in any object, in any relationship? Nothing. So only then I can really lift my intellect and hold Baba. Live in Baba's world. So that means many times Baba says, no, look at this world as a graveyard. Graveyard who lives? Dead bodies only. So who will be the sensible person who will go and attach their heart to the dead bodies when they don't get anything? So everybody is dead. Everything is dead. No life. So I don't need to let my intellect get stuck here. But if I have taste in both ways, I cannot go deeper into meditation. So that is why Baba says, you know, recognition of Baba. Who is Baba? You know, what occupation Baba's occupation is. What is he to me? I need to understand clearly. So this is why, you know, we talk about when we are thinking about the depth of yoga, you cannot just go deep like that. You know, it's a commitment. You have to commit your life to someone. Only then you can go deeper. So it is not only the depth. As deeper you want to go, such thoughts quality has to be also very elevated. If my thoughts are not elevated, if my thoughts are not pure, if my thoughts are not powerful, I cannot dive deeper. Just like when they build a house, you know, if they want to build some building higher, the foundation has to be deep. The depth and the length has to match. So I have to teach myself to think, you know, more pure thoughts, elevated thoughts, that will take me into the depth. And of course, you know, how long you can keep those thoughts. So anyway, when we talk about yogi life, it has four dimensions. You know, when you are talking about yoga and yogi life, it is like building a building. You are building your life. So it has four dimensions. It has depth also, it has height also, it has length also, and it has width also. So all four dimensions must be matching. Then only you can build a yogi life, create a stage in yoga. So how many hours a day we are remembering Baba? You know, for the sake of saying, we say, oh, I am Baba's child, I never forget. So that is like zero. That means they don't remember at all. They are pleasing themselves saying that they remember Baba 24 hours. That is not possible. So that is why Baba has given us at least minimum 8 hours a day. No, he has given us 24 hours. 8 hours you do locking job. 8 hours you sleep, 8 hours you do Baba service and Baba's remembrance. So ask yourself, how many hours a day I really remember Baba. Yeah? Not struggling, battling remembrance, just pure remembrance. Pure remembrance means nobody and nothing should come in between me and Baba. Nobody and nothing. That is called pure remembrance. So how many hours do I have? That quality remembrance. So because if I have unadulterated love for Baba, then I can have unadulterated remembrance. Unadulterated means only one and no one. Nothing is included. But if one thing is coming and removing, another thing is coming and removing, that is called struggle. To have that unadulterated remembrance, I should have unadulterated love. Unadulterated love, which means exclusive love for Baba, in which nobody is included. You know, if somebody else is also included in Baba's remembrance, that is not unadulterated. So that is why we have to be very careful in living our life. You know, if I say mine is only one Baba and none other, I must mean it. It's just like a faithful wife, you know, Pativrata. She would never remember another man except the one whom she is married. Otherwise, she is not called loyal. She is not called faithful. So I have to be like that with Baba. Such loyalty, such faithfulness that I don't have anybody else in my life as my husband, as my friend, as my mother, except Baba. Then only the remembrance can be frequent. Because any relationship I remember, I will have only Baba and none other. So from remembrance, I have to make it intense. That is called tapasya. When the remembrance becomes troublesome, intense, fire, that is called tapasya. Tapa means heat. No, tapasya is heating process. Intense meditation. There is no interruptions in meditation. That is called intense. Non-stop. Lagatar. So that is intense. So such kind of remembrance when I have for 8 hours, then I can expect my sins to be burnt. Right? So, in order to do that kind of tapasya, tapasya is not like some Brahmins, you know, they say, okay, I'm doing tapasya today, they will go and sit in Baba's room alone and sleep away 4 hours. And they write in the chart, I remembered Baba for 4 hours. But if sitting in Baba's room is not doing remembrance. You may sit for 1 hour, but how many minutes you really remembered Baba? Exclusive. That is what to be counted. Not like hours, you know. I sat there for how many hours? That doesn't matter. So that is where the, you know, intensity comes. So in olden days, rishis and munis used to do tapasya. When you use the word tapasya, what comes to your mind? Where the tapasya is practiced? You know, it is in the cave. In olden days, rishis, munis used to go and sit in the cave where there is no noise of this world to be heard and nothing of this world to be seen. You know, they were just on their own. And And they had that concentration. Tapasya means concentration and determination. Even though their yoga was wrong, they were concentrating on the element of light, but they still had concentration. We don't have that concentration now. Our mind wanders 10 times, you know, who comes, who goes, and what happens sitting in yoga. But they were so focused, that the power of their concentration, vibrations of that concentration went out far and wide. You know, like a volcano, when it erupts, the lava goes far away. So the vibrations of their pure remembrance, purity. So people used to come and, serve them, bring food and everything on the basis of the vibrations they got. They did not make an announcement. I am sitting in this cave, come and see me. They never expected anybody. But people got attracted because of their purity. Because of the vibration, even the animals around them became tame. Tapasya, you know. So tapasya is not an ordinary term. You cannot feel sleepy in tapasya. There is no word like that. It's like Shankar, Master Shankar. That is the image. You know, how is Master Shankar sitting? Totally alert. That's why eyes open. Shankar's eyes are open. And he's always shown to be seated in the crematorium. And he's always shown naked. Why? Because, you know, this world is like a graveyard. So he doesn't have any attachment. The third eye is open and totally beyond the consciousness of the body. So that is how tapasya is done. We use the word tapasya for our advantage. But there is no fire lit, no transformation of the sanskaras. So for practicing tapasya also, I must go into the cave of introversion. You cannot do tapasya without being introvert. So when you turn within, you become introvert. It is like going to your own private room. And after going into that room of introversion, you have to create a soundproof atmosphere, just like in a cage. So what is that soundproof atmosphere? Solitude. Total solitude. No sound from outside is coming in and no noise from inside going out. Soundproof. Total silence. Tapasya means total silence, not sleeping, not sleeping silence. That is dead. This is really striking, you know, fire, silence, deep, deep silence. Because you dive deep into yourself in tapasya, you know, you become the embodiment of what you are thinking. So that depth is there. So for practicing tapasya, I really need concentration. You know, 5 things Baba talks about tapasya. One is ekvrata, faithful. Faithful to Baba in all relationship. Ekvrata, ekagrata, concentration. Ekant, solitude, and ekras, stability, and eknami, only name of one. Of course, it brings economy. No thoughts are wasted. So that is called tapasya. So in that tapasya fire of yoga, my sins are burnt, which means the heat intensity reaches to my subconsciousness. The seed of my sanskara is burnt. practice attention. So first I need to ignite the fire of love in my heart. You know, Baba talks about Laila and Majnu. You have heard about the story, lover and beloved. You know, they were in love with each other, not for any vices, but they just had attraction towards the body of each other, and they did not have any impure thoughts, but still the remembrance of each other was so intense that once Majnu, the beloved, was remembering Laila, and he was just, his eyes were open, but he could not see anything except Laila everywhere. So he was running in the forest, you know, calling out name of Laila. So he did not see, there was a Muslim brother who was doing prayers, namaz. So he just walked on him, you know, he walked on him. Because he couldn't see anybody, you know, they say love makes you blind. So this Muslim brother got angry and he said, what, you did not see me doing namaz for Allah? He said, what, your love for God is that much that you can see me? My love is better than yours. I couldn't even see you. Right? So if third person comes in between me and Baba, that is what is remembrance. How can you allow the third person to come when you are in love with Baba? They shouldn't. But if they come, that means you love that person more than you love Baba. That is why that person knows. So this is why we must keep this understanding. I should love one, I should love all. Don't have extra love for one person. That's the problem. If you have extra love for even one person, that person is going to come in between you and Baba. They know. And don't allow anybody to have extra love for you. Don't become happy. Because you are going to go in between them and Baba. So my remembrance becomes adulterated. That's why Baba says, if you love, love everyone. And what is love after all? It is not, emotions, or it is not anything physical. It's accepting each other, understanding each other, selflessness, that's all. Baba loves us. You know, how do we know? Does Baba love all of you?
Yes.
How do you know? He don't come and tell you, I love you. No, but how do you feel? What happens? How do you know?
We just feel it.
No, but you can't just feel it. But what is the feeling of love? Yeah? What is that feeling?
So when we need him, he's always.
What is that feeling? God loves me.
Happy.
Yeah, he does love everyone, definitely. That is why we are here. See, God gives love, three forms of love.
Actually, when
I am in the in bhakti, Baba used to give me love because he wants to make from bhakti to gyan. After coming to gyan, he gives love, so that we don't get caught up in Maya. But the real love, that one will receive those who are obedient. So you can ask yourself, what kind of love? Is Baba giving me love so to rescue me from Maya? Or is it really the obedience that bringing me love? But more than that, how do you know Baba loves you? You can't just pretend and say, you know. Then why do you have attachment with others if God loves you? Why your intellect wanders? So first of all, I want to know, how do you know God loves you? Just answer.
We get the pull from Baba time to time.
So what is the sign of Baba loving me?
He accepts me as his child.
Self-respect?
Huh?
Self-respect. You have self-respect.
Uh-huh. Self-respect.
Srimad.
No, Srimad Baba gives to everybody. Actually, if you think about it deeply, you know, there is a song in Hindi, beautifully it says, Jaane kya dekha mujhme, mujhse pyar kar liya. Oh God, what did you see in me that you liked so much that you fell in love with me? What did Baba see in me that he liked very much, that he began to love me? Do you recognize? What did he see in you? Each one of us different. That he liked. So he fell in love with me first, before I do. Right? We did not find God. He found us. That means he loves us more than we love him. We were searching him in wrong places. Yeah? Temple and stones and pilgrimages and all that. And he knew exactly, so he went and picked you from that place. So how did you know that he loves you there?
Because he picked us up.
Now, what feelings I got? You know, it's only because, see, Baba is incorporeal. You cannot touch to feel the love, because in physical, you can feel the love physically. But here, it is only through feelings and vibrations. Right? So, you recall your own experience. Don't be in a rush to answer. You recall your own experience. First time, when I experienced Baba's love, what happened? You know, one time, I tell you one of the experience of one of the Baba's child. You know, 1 year Baba did not, Baba means Baba's method of meeting is changing all the time. So 1 year, Baba was not speaking to anyone, but everybody will go on the stage and 1 second drishti. New and old, everybody. So there was one first timer who went on the stage to take drishti. So when that soul came down, I asked that soul, did you meet God? Yeah? So he said, yes, because Baba was not speaking, only drishti. So that soul said, yes, I met. So how do you know you met God? He said, he loves me. How? He acknowledged by saying he accepted me. You know, Baba did like this. So the soul felt that Baba accepted me as I am. So that means he loves me. So what is God's love is acceptance. And that is why Baba said, you belong to me. How he adopted us? He said, you belong to me, and I said, I belong to you. Finish, adoption happened. But Baba accepted me first, just like a mother accept her child, no matter how the child is. So you recall your experience. Acceptance, as I am, what I am, who I am, without questioning. So then I accepted. So if I have that kind of love from Baba, I cannot touch somebody else to get another type of love. So that is why many of us find yoga difficult. Because we want to experience love from other people and also love from Baba. So Baba doesn't touch that soul who is already influenced by other soul, touched by other soul. So I have to be untouchable. That means my intellect should not be pulled towards human beings to experience love. Then I receive God's love. If I have experienced God's love, then I love everyone. That's the proof. I don't have any disliking for anyone. I love one and I love all. So this is the leakage. You know what happens? Either we have attraction or repulsion. Either we have push or pull. Either we have dislike or like. That is why our yoga is difficult. So we have to go beyond that. If I want to really have tapasya, you know, focused on one, I have to go beyond all this. You know, no attachment, no likingness, no dislikingness. Not getting impressed, not getting repulsed. So then my intellect is intact. So that is why my intellect doesn't focus on Baba. This is the leakage. You know, if you hate someone, you remember that person more. Of course, if you have attraction towards someone, you will remember them. That is natural. But if you hate someone, that person's remembrance is also intense. You don't like them, so they come to you. So I should not have that at all, dharana. I like everyone. I like one and all. So I don't have pull for anybody. You know? So I must really look at my tapasya, my stage of yoga. Who comes in between? You know? So I must remove that person. I must replace that person by Baba. Then only I can have tapasya. See, depth of yoga means deep stages in yoga. Yoga has four stages, right? One is soul consciousness, then churning knowledge, heart-to-heart conversation, and seed stage. That is the fire of yoga. So you cannot begin with that seed stage. You have to master the soul conscious stage. And you can experience soul conscious stage in four ways. Either subtle soul consciousness, gross soul consciousness, bodiless stage, incorporeal stage, and then churning knowledge, heart-to-heart conversation of different relationship. So these things will allow you to become full. You know, the soul becomes full with all the love of relationship, all the knowledge. So when I am full, then naturally I experience the seed stage. But if there is emptiness, I cannot. So there are certain dharana that is necessary to dive deep into yoga stages. So first is total soul consciousness. Because if I am not totally soul conscious, there is no way I can dive deeper. I cannot even get connected. Secondly, I need to have purity. Purity is a must. Purity and yoga are two sides of the same coin. If there is no purity, there is no yoga. Purity, as I mentioned last night also, thought, words, action and relationship. So the more purity I practice consciously, the better yoga I have. And thirdly, I have to be introvert. I should be a lover of solitude. You know?
Say, for example, listening to music is not anything wrong. But if you indulge in it and enjoy the sensations created through that sound, it is called lust. So you will not be able to enjoy meditation. That's why you know some souls, when the music is played, they are swaying like this. And once the music is over, they will fall. So what stage is that? I don't need to have yoga with the music. I don't need to have yoga with the lights. I don't need yoga with the clock. Some people are always watching the clock. Why the clock is stopped? It's already not moving. Some people are waiting for the light to be changed. As soon as white light comes, so they are already too fast. So am I having yoga with Baba? So I have to really make sure that nothing of this world, I don't take support of anything to get my yoga connected. It's nothing wrong to use red light. There's nothing wrong to use the music, nothing wrong to stick to the time. But I don't need to connect myself with that. You know, some souls cannot meditate if there is no red light. Some souls cannot meditate without music. So no, my meditation has to be totally not depending on any physical devices. But it doesn't mean that you don't have to use. See, when we have such a stage where we are totally beyond the attraction of the things made out of elements of matter, that is called sadhana. Sadhana is spiritual endeavor. You know, that will lead us to Jwalamukhi yoga, volcanic. Volcanic yoga is what? It's double fire, you know. See, in the sky, when you see two clouds colliding, what happens? Lightning comes. And when two lightning collide, thunder. So here, volcanic yoga is what? I, the soul light, I merge in the love of the supreme light. So that power cannot be measured by any scientific measurement. And that intensity of fire not only burned the seat of my samskara, but the vibration like lava can reach far away. But if my meditation is not even reaching to my own inside samskara, how will it reach outside? So I must see, you know, volcanic means depth over a long period of time. Depth. You know, the volcano is not produced in one day. It accumulates the heat over a period of time. And then one day it becomes active. So that means I have to be in that intense love with Baba to such an extent. You know, that fire. You see, fire ignites fire. Right? Jyoti se jyoti jagate chal. Fire ignites fire. If I have not ignited the fire of love in my heart, how can you have the fire of yoga? It's double fire. Fiery form. You know, fiery form. Is important. So every time I sit in yoga, I have to make up my mind properly, understand and dive deeper to such an extent that I am not disturbed. You know, it's not like bhakti, you know, some people
they will be chanting, oh, your milkman has come, take the milk. Oh, then again, bhakti. Oh, then open the door. You know. Like, that is bhakti, you see. So, that is how they do. But we cannot do yoga like that. We're sitting like this and then somebody comes. Okay, then we sit like this. No, that cannot be intense yoga.
This world, I disappear from this world. I get lost in Baba and disappear. But it's not that you're falling asleep. No. Falling asleep is so totally different. When you're sleeping, you don't know you're sleeping. Other people will know. But you yourself will know. Yeah? But when I'm in deep yoga, I will know. And then the vibration others will know. That's the beauty of it. You know, when you are in the bodiless stage, you will know. But when you are in the sleep, you will not know. That is also bodiless stage. Yeah? What is the difference between sleep and bodiless stage? Very, very close. You know, when you have good sleep, that is also bodiless stage. But that bodiless stage is involuntary. But here, bodiless state is voluntary. You are aware you are in that state. Right? So, by the way, who sleeps at night? Huh? You all slept last night? Yeah? Who slept?
Body.
Body, yeah? Body don't sleep. Then you, why don't you say, I body slept last night very well. You say, no, I slept very well. Or you say, I couldn't sleep. Who is I? So who sleeps? Soul sleeper. No, soul don't sleep. Because, you know, your mind, intellect is working, you get dreams and things like that. So soul cannot sleep. So body don't sleep, soul don't sleep. Who sleeps?
Sense of organ.
Sense organs. Why don't you say there is sense of what you sleep? What is the definition of sleep? Sleep is only when I, the soul, you know, I use this body whole day, so the body gets tired. So what I say is sleep means I disengage my sense organs from my sense organs. I, the soul, I disengage myself from the sense organs. That is called sleep. Not the body, not the soul. Right? So when you are able to practice detachment several times during the day and before going to sleep, you have good sleep. But if you don't practice, you are worrying, you're watching TV, you got nightmares then. You cannot sleep. Right? So that is why we say if you want to have a sound sleep doesn't mean snoring and sleeping. You know? So one time Jagdish Bhai went to some center, you know, somebody was also sleeping. So next morning they asked him, how did you sleep? He said, I had a very good sound sleep. Because the person who was sleeping with him was snoring whole night. Sound sleep. So what we mean by sound sleep means no disturbance. That is quality sleep. So if you want to have that kind of sleep, where you are not disturbed, so you have to take rest during the day. Rest is separate from sleep. See, in Hindi, sleep is called sona. Rest is called aram. Yeah? You know, one day what happened? There was Jagadguru Sammelan, no? So, during that time, one Swami wanted to meet Dadi Janaki. Dadi Janaki was resting, sleeping.
How can she say to that big Swami that our administrator is sleeping? So this sister was very, very smart. She said, our Dadi is in, what she said, no. She said something very royal word in that very Aram stage of yoga. Yeah, there is word there. So that sannyasi understood.
Vishram.
So, you know, Aram is different. Vishram is also different. Now they have waiting room. What they call it?
Vishramgar.
Rest house. So what is rest and what is sleep? So rest is also disengaging myself from the sense organs. So you can have four types of rest during the day. So you can have a good sleep at night. One is called sensory rest. That means the eyes get tired during the day, looking nowadays computer screen, you know. So the nerves in the eyes get tired. So what I need to do is every hour, few hours, just close your eyes and relax the eye muscle. It's not taking nap or sleep, resting the eyes. So you will feel relaxed. And the second rest is called emotional rest. Because many times we get involved in other people's life and other people's emotions and we get disturbed. So don't allow your emotion to be involved in other people's life. Rest emotionally. And thirdly, mental rest. Don't think too much waste about other people. And sometimes that is also one of the reasons we cannot sleep. So rest your mind. And then fourth is physical rest. What they say is that, you know, you just lie on the floor flat, what they call shavasana, death posture, like a tortoise, you know, just for a few minutes during the day, you just practice shavasana, death posture, physical, as if you are totally separate from the body, and that gives rest to the body. So if I have these four types of rest, then when I want to sleep, it is easy. I can disengage myself. Yeah.
Meera, one of the greatest challenges for this soul is absorbing the emotions of others.
Yeah.
It's very empathetic. So are there any special tips you could give for protection from?
What Baba says is that, you know, I show pity for others and that is why I absorb their emotions. So change your practice from having pity to mercy. So when you have mercy for others, you don't absorb their emotion. Being beyond, coming to sound in the state of being beyond, and then come to the sound and then go back. Then only we can take the souls into the experience. So that practice is lacking. No, we have to do it. Okay, so start with first, second stage soul consciousness. And that's what I was telling one of the sisters. I said, if you are not soul conscious, you cannot connect with Baba, you know. First of all, I need to master soul conscious state. Because it is the soul that is connected with Baba, you know. And Baba is not a person. You know, some people, when we say God is point of light, they begin to stare at this electric point of light, thinking that is God. They get headache. So you don't need to stare at that point. That is just to remind you. But in your own mind, you need to visualize God as a living light like you, who has feelings, who has emotion, who have
intellect, you know. So I can connect with Baba and receive that feeling. So when I connect with Baba, I am connecting with the personality of that light, not the physical light. Suppose if I am connecting with you, with what am I connecting? Your personality. So your energy influences me. Your personality influences me. When we say satsang, the company of truth, the Baba's personality influences me because I remain in his company, company colors. But sometimes we don't do the yoga properly. We try to connect with that static point. Nothing comes out of it. So we get tired, after that we feel sleepy. But if you really understand, God is light, yes. But he is living energy like me. But he is supreme energy, that is all. The reason is, he is ever pure, he is truth. So I need to connect with the personality of God. Light attracts light. So the more soul conscious I am, the more I am attracted to the supreme soul like me. You know, in science, opposite pole attract. In silence, light attracts light. That is why the more soul conscious we are, the more we are pulled to Baba like a magnet. I don't have to make effort because light attracts light. So then I take God's personality into myself. You know, God's personality. Like Baba is ocean of peace, connecting with him, so I slowly draw that peace. God is ocean of love, God is almighty authority, so I draw that personality into myself. That is why one day we become an angel. Who is an angel? Human in form, godly in nature. So God's personality in human form, that is angelic form. No? So how angels got that personality? That so close connection with the Supreme Soul. So that is why Baba says, don't complain to Baba saying, I forget Baba. You cannot forget Baba. But you cannot remember Baba constantly also because you are not soul conscious. You know, during the day, once Dadi Kulsar was saying, we are not soul conscious. We are not body conscious. We are not God conscious. We are not even unconscious. So what consciousness do we have during the day? Action conscious. That is why we are weak in yoga. We say karma yoga, but we are action conscious, karam conscious. We are only thinking of the action. We are too much into gross. So my thoughts are ordinary. So that is why I find a lot of time to connect myself. So karma yoga means, whilst performing karma, not to be karam conscious, but to be soul conscious and God conscious. If I am, then I am conqueror of my senses, conqueror of my sense organs, conqueror of my mind intellect. I am able to use them the way I want. If not, I am karma conscious. So I have to change that, you know, that action consciousness. So we are thinking too much in detail about the action we are doing. You know, like say, if I'm action conscious, I am performing action in bondage with the sense organs. If I'm soul conscious, I am performing action in relationship. Just give you an example. Say, I am cooking food. So now, when I'm cooking food, how I am karma conscious? I'm thinking, oh, my husband will come. You know, I'm cooking food, he will like it very much, and then he will praise me and he will like me. So I'm cooking food, like I'm thinking, you know, am performing action with the desire of receiving the fruit of that action, so whole attention is towards every detail of the action. So now the husband comes, and he eats food, and he say nothing, he just goes. So now I am worried. I am thinking, I don't know what, whether he likes it or not, you know. Until I follow up, I will not be able to sleep in peace. You know, because I was expecting that he will praise me, he will like and he will say, very nicely done, very tasty. Then I get acknowledgement, you know, approval, then I feel good. So I didn't get that. So that is current conscious. You know, this is what, like sometimes we give a talk, we give a class, we give a lecture, and then after that we are waiting, anybody says anything for us. And sometimes nobody says anything, everybody gets up and goes. So inside I am feeling guilty. You know, I don't know whether I did it or not. I thought everybody, nobody said anything. But it doesn't matter. Why I want to follow up? So that means I am doing it with the expectation. I will get praise, I will get name and fame, and I feel good. So that is action conscious. So if I am performing action in relationship, I am doing it just as an observer. I am making the sense organs do. You know, this is why karan karavan har should be practiced in both ways. Say, if I am doing action through my body, I am taking bath, I am dressing myself, I am ironing my clothes. So I cannot ask Baba karan karavan har, Baba is doing it. I am doing it. So I, the soul, I am karan har. I am the soul, I am karavanhar. I, the soul, I am doing it and getting it done through the body. So then I will not be karam conscious. But I only remember I am doing it. So then I become action conscious. But I call Baba karan karavanhar when I am on the field of service. So when I am on the field of service, I say, Baba, I am only instrument. It's your task. You come and do. So that is different. So to go beyond karan consciousness, I have to practice karan karavan har, the body and the soul. Soul is karan har and also karavan har. It does and gets it done through sense organs. So then I will not perform action in bondage to the sense organs. So that is why, you know, our remembrance is not intact, you know, because if I am not soul conscious, I cannot hold Baba in my intellect, because the soul and supreme soul are related, isn't it? So if I am sitting in body consciousness like bhakti, I am remembering Baba, nothing happens. In bhakti also same thing, you know, I consider myself as a human being and praying to God. Of course, I get a little return for my bhavna, but not really the experience of getting connected. So that is why we have to tell Baba, it's not we forget you, but we forget we are soul. So that is what we have to practice a lot. So first lesson is very important. Even though it looks easy, but it is most difficult. Right? We have been practicing for so many years, yet not finished yet. So that's very important. So practice attention. Yeah? Three P's we have to remember. Practice patience and perseverance. Keep doing it. Keep doing it. Don't get tired. See, dadis are practicing for 8 years. Still they are. We haven't done it even for 8 years already, we are tired. No. Keep doing it. Okay. So try to improve, you know, day by day. Yeah. Okay, so we have to finish now.
11:30.